Hi everyone, it's Professor Pemberton. In this video, we're going to talk about derivatives of logarithmic functions. In a previous video, we talked about a review of logarithmic functions and the properties of logarithms. In this video, we're going to talk about how to find the derivative of logarithmic and natural logarithmic functions, and also how to use logarithmic functions in the applications involving business, economic, social, and physical sciences. So let's start with the derivatives of logarithmic functions. The following list of derivative formulas will actually provide us a way to find the derivative of logarithmic functions of any base b. Remember, the base must be a positive number, but not equal to 1, for a logarithm. The derivatives of logarithms. If x is positive, that's because the x is the argument of the logarithm, b is the base, so it must be positive, and the base cannot be 1, then the derivative of a logarithmic function with base b, an argument x, is the derivative with respect to x of log base b of x is 1 divided by x times natural log of the base of the logarithm, that's in the denominator. So in the above derivative rule for logarithmic functions, if we choose the base to be the number e, then we get the natural logarithm. Log base b of x becomes log base e of x, which is natural log of x, and the formula would simplify. You would have 1 divided by x times natural log of the base. Well, if you're talking about natural log, it'd be natural log of e, and we know natural log of e is 1. So the formula simplifies to the derivative with respect to x of the natural log of x is just simply 1 divided by x. So example 7, we're going to find derivatives of log functions. Find the derivatives of the following functions. Number 1, so y equals 2 times e to the x, so that's an exponential expression. Subtract 5 times log base 9 of x, and that's a log function. So if you want to find the derivative would be y prime or dy dx if you're using Leibniz notation. It's the derivative of the entire function. And now notice that you have to use two different types of rules because you have two different types of functions. The first term is an exponential function. Take the derivative of that term. And then the second term is a log function, so take the derivative of 5 times log base 7 of x separately. So when you do that, you'll have 2 as a coefficient, so keep it. Then take the derivative of e to the x, keep the sign between the derivatives, 5 as a coefficient, so keep it, and then the derivative of log base 9 of x. Well, we know what the derivative of e to the x is, it's itself. So you have 2 times e to the x, subtract 5, and then the derivative of a log function. Well, we're going to use the first rule because this is base 9 logarithm. So log base 9 of x, the derivative would be 1 divided by x, the argument, times natural log of the base of the logarithm. So it's natural log of 9. Now to simplify just a bit, you have the derivative is 2 times e to the x, that's the first term, subtract, and then the second term, you have 5 times 1 in the numerator, so 5 divided by x times natural log of 9, that's all in the denominator. All right, number 2. This time we're going to take the derivative of y equals 2 times log of x, so that's the common logarithm, base 10 logarithm, plus 3 to the x power. So again, you have a log function, and the other term is an exponential function. So we're going to take the derivative of each term separately. So y prime is dy dx, or it's the derivative of the entire function. So take the derivative of the first term, take the derivative of the second term, using the sum rule for derivatives. So y prime is dy dx. Again, 2 is a coefficient, so keep it. Take the derivative of the log function, which I wrote in base 10 because that's the common logarithm. So take the derivative of log base 10 of x, and then take the derivative of the exponential function separately, d dx of 3 to the x power. So 2 is a coefficient, keep it. The derivative of log base 10 of x is 1 divided by x, which is the argument, times natural log of the base, which was natural log of 10, plus the derivative of 3 to the x. Well, it's an exponential function, so the derivative of 3 to the x is itself. But then notice that the base is 3, it's not base e like the last problem, so you have to multiply by natural log of 3 as well. So to simplify, for this first term you have 2 times 1, so you have 2 divided by x times natural log of 10 in the denominator, and the second term is already simplified, plus 3 to the x times natural log of 3. Now the third problem, number 3, says take the derivative of y equals x to the fifth power, so that's a power function, plus 7 times natural log of x, so a log function. So again, take the derivative, y prime is dy dx. It's the derivative of the entire function, so take the derivative of each term separately. So y prime, dy dx, it's the derivative of x to the fifth. Well, we know that's the power rule it used to take the derivative, so that's 5x to the fourth power. Power goes down to the front, makes it a coefficient, subtract 1 from the power on x. 7 is the coefficient, so keep it. And then the derivative of natural log of x, we talked about earlier, the derivative is 1 divided by x, so you'll have 7 times 1 over x. And then simplify. You have 5x to the fourth is the first term, and the second term is 7 times 1, so 7, divided by x. Number 4. This time we have y equals log base 8 of 6x, subtract natural log of 3 divided by x as the argument of the second logarithm, subtract 10 times e to the ninth power. So notice that the arguments of the logarithms are not just simply x this time. The first logarithm has 6x as the argument, and the second logarithm, the natural log, has 3 divided by x as its argument. So we need to use the log properties first to simplify each logarithm before we actually find the derivative. It'll simplify each logarithm, and then we can find the derivative more easily. So this is the original function, y equals log base 8 of 6x, subtract natural log of 3 divided by x, subtract 10 times e to the ninth. Well, notice the first term, the first logarithm, has 6 times x as its argument. That's a product. You can use the product law to separate this first logarithm into a sum of logarithms with base 8. So log base 8 of 6 plus log base 8 of x using the product law. And then the second logarithm, notice you have a quotient inside the argument. So you'll need to rewrite this as a difference of logarithms, so subtract. So be very careful. When we rewrite a logarithm into a sum or a difference, it needs to go in parentheses because we're rewriting one logarithm into two logarithms. So this becomes natural log of 3 using the quotient law, subtract natural log of the denominator, which was x. So natural log of x. And then the last term isn't a logarithm, so it stays exactly as it is, 10 e to the ninth. And now you can simplify even further. Notice there's a negative sign that was before the second logarithm, but we rewrote it into a difference. So this negative sign needs to be distributed to both logarithms. So you'll have y equals log base 8 of 6 plus log base 8 of x, subtract natural log of 3 plus natural log of x, and then subtract 10 e to the ninth power. The arguments are 6, x, 3, and x. Now we can take the derivative of each term separately. So the derivative of log base 8 of 6, notice that there's no x as the variable in this first logarithm, so it's just a constant, and we know the derivative of a constant is 0. The second logarithm does have an x, so the derivative of log base 8 of x, it's 1 divided by x, using the log rule for derivatives, times natural log of the base, which was 8. So x times natural log of 8 in the denominator. The third logarithm is natural log of 3, so again, does not involve the variable, it's a constant. And the derivative of natural log of 3 is 0. Then you have natural log of x. We had a rule for this. The derivative of natural log of x was 1 divided by x. And then 10 times e to the ninth. Notice that the variable doesn't appear. You have the base is the number e, and the exponent is also a number 9. And so this is just a constant, and the derivative of 0. And so now to simplify, you have 1 divided by x times natural log of 8. That's one term. And then you have 1 divided by x. That's another term. So this is the derivative of y. Number 5, this time we have the function y equals 7 times natural log of, in the argument, 3 times the 4th root of x, subtract 8 times the 5th root of x. So again, we're going to need to use the log properties to simplify each logarithm before we actually find the derivative, because we have a product inside this first logarithm. So let's rewrite the function, y is equal to 7 times natural log of 3 times the 4th root of x. We know that we can rewrite the 4th root of x as a power of x. It's x to the 1/4 power. So you have 7 times natural log of 3 times x to the 1/4. And then we also can rewrite the 5th root of x as a fraction power. So minus 8 times x to the 1/5 power for the 5th root. So now notice you have a product on the inside of the natural log. So we can use the product law to separate natural log of 3 from natural log of x to the 1/4. So 7 on the outside, and now we're rewriting this logarithm, so it needs to go in parentheses. The natural log of the first factor, which was 3, so natural log of 3, plus, because it's the product law, natural log of x to the 1/4 is the other logarithm. And then outside the parentheses, you have minus 8x to the 1/5. But we're not finished simplifying yet. Notice that this second logarithm, this natural log of x to the 1/4, has a power on x inside the argument. You can bring the 1/4 down to make it a coefficient. And then, also, you can distribute the 7 to both of these logarithms. So, after you simplify, you'll have y is equal to 7 times natural log of 3, plus 7 times, we took 1/4 down to a coefficient, so 7 times 1/4 times natural log of x, and the last term is still 8x to the 1/5 power. And then, simplifying, you have 7 natural log of 3, 7 times 1/4 is 7/4, so 7/4 natural log of x, and subtract 8x to the 1/5. Now we're ready to actually take the derivative, because the arguments are just 3 and just x of the logarithms. So y prime dy dx is the derivative of each term separately, all three terms. Notice the first term does not involve x, or the variable, so the derivative is just a derivative of a constant function, which is 0. The second term, you have a coefficient 7/4, so keep it. The derivative of natural log of x was 1 divided by x, using the derivative rule. And then the last term, you have to use the power rule because this is a power function. So negative 8 stays, that's the coefficient. And then take the derivative of x to the 1/5. 1/5 comes down as the coefficient. And you subtract 1 from the power. 1/5 subtract 1 becomes negative 4/5. So after you simplify, you'll have 7/4 times 1 over x becomes 7 divided by 4x in the denominator. Subtract 8 times 1/5 becomes 8/5. And then x to negative 4/5. So y prime is 7 divided by 4x. Subtract 8/5 x to the negative 4/5 power. So now that we know how to take derivatives of logarithm functions, we actually can go back to the original problem that we're really focused with derivatives, and that's the tangent line problem. So example 8, the tangent line problem, find the equation of the tangent line to the graph, and this function contains a logarithm. F of x is equal to 2 times natural log of x to the 4th, subtract 6, find the equation of the tangent line at the point e, 2 on the graph. So just to give you an idea of what this function's graph looks like, this is the function f of x equals 2 times natural log of x to the 4th, subtract 6. It looks like there's going to be a vertical asymptote at the y-axis because the graph is going down very quickly. But we're interested in what's the slope of the tangent line and the equation of the tangent line at this point, e, 2. So we know that if we want to find the equation of the tangent line, we also need to find the slope of the tangent line, and that involves the derivative. So let's take the derivative of this function. Now notice that this function contains a logarithm, and this logarithm contains x to the 4th inside the argument. So that means we have to use the power rule first to simplify the function before taking the derivative. So f of x is equal to 2 times natural log of x to the 4th. Bring the 4 to make it a coefficient first. So you'll have f of x is equal to 2 times 4 times natural log of x, and then subtract 6 is still there. So this is really 8 times natural log of x, subtract 6. So now we can take the derivative more easily. So the derivative f prime of x is equal to, 8 is a coefficient, so keep it. The derivative of natural log of x was 1 divided by x, and the derivative of 6, derivative of a constant, is 0. So simplifying, this becomes 8 divided by x, so that's f prime of x. So now that we have the derivative, is f prime of x is 8 divided by x, now we can find the slope of the tangent line at this point, e, 2. So notice that the x-coordinate is x equals e. We can plug in x equals e into the derivative to find the slope of the tangent line at this point. So f prime, when replacing x with an e, you'll get 8 divided by e. So that's the slope of the tangent line at this point. And so now that we have the slope of the tangent line, and we know the tangent line must pass through this point, e, 2, that's on the graph, then we can find out the equation of the tangent line using point slope form. We have the slope, and we have a point, so we can use this form. Y subtract y1 is equal to the slope times x minus x1 in parentheses. So when you plug in the point, when you plug in the slope of the tangent line, y subtract 2, the y coordinate of the point, equals the slope of the tangent line, which was 8 divided by e, times the quantity x subtract the x coordinate of the point, which was e. So if you want to get the equation of the tangent line, we need to isolate the y on one side of the equation. So remove the parentheses by distributing this slope through the parentheses. So 8 divided by e times x becomes 8 divided by e x. And 8 divided by e times e, the e's will cancel each other out, and you'll just have minus 8 left over. So y subtract 2 is equal to 8 divided by e times x, subtract 8, and then add 2 to both sides of the equation, and you have the equation of the tangent line is y equals 8 divided by e is the slope, times x, and then subtract 6. Alright, so the last example, we're going to talk about an application of derivatives of log functions involving revenue, cost, and profit functions. So example 9, revenue and cost functions. The total revenue and the total cost functions are given as the cost function, c of x is 18,000 plus x. The revenue function is negative 6,000 times natural log of 2 divided by x in the argument, where x is the number of items produced and sold, and we're assuming in this problem that x must be greater than or equal to 1. So part 1. Find the profit function, capital P of x. So we know from previous video that the profit function is the revenue subtract the cost, or capital P of x is capital R of x, the revenue, subtract capital C of x, the cost. So when you do this, you'll have negative 6,000 times natural log of 2 divided by x, so that's the revenue function. Now subtract the entire cost function, so subtract 18,000 plus x, that goes in parentheses because we know we have to distribute the negative to both terms. But there's something else that we can do to simplify the function as well. Notice that this logarithm from the revenue function has a quotient inside the argument. So we can use the quotient law to simplify. So negative 6,000 That goes on the outside of the parentheses because we're going to rewrite this logarithm using the quotient law as natural log of the numerator, which is natural log of 2, then subtract natural log of the denominator, which is natural log of x. And then when you distribute the negative through this second set of parentheses, you'll have negative 18,000 and then negative x. So negative 6,000 can be distributed through this first set of parentheses after we use the quotient law. So negative 6,000 times natural log of 2. And then negative 6,000 times negative natural log of x becomes positive 6,000 natural log of x. And the other two terms stay the same. And so that's the profit function. P of x is negative 6,000 natural log of 2 plus 6,000 natural log of x, subtract 18,000, subtract x. Now part 2. Find the rate of change of the total profit in terms of x. So we're talking about a rate of change in the profit function. We know that's the marginal profit, or p prime of x. So we need to take the derivative of the function that we came up with for profit in the first part. So we have to take the derivative of negative 6,000 natural log of 2 plus 6,000 natural log of x, subtract 18,000, subtract x. So we can take the derivative of each term separately. Notice that the first term is negative 6,000 times natural log of 2. That's just a constant because it doesn't involve x, so the derivative is 0. The next term is 6,000 times natural log of x. The derivative of natural log of x was 1 divided by x, and 6,000 is a coefficient, so keep it. So 6,000 times 1 over x. 18,000 is a constant, so the derivative is 0. And the derivative of x is 1. And so the derivative of p prime, the marginal profit function, is 6,000 divided by x, subtract 1. Now before we use the marginal profit function, part 3 is saying, find the total profit when 3,000 items and 9,000 items are sold. Round your answers to the nearest cent, or two decimal places. So we're not using the marginal profit, it's using the total profit. So the total profit was what we came up with in part 1. P of x was negative 6,000 times natural log of 2, plus 6,000 times natural log of x, subtract 18,000, subtract x. So to figure out what the total profit would be at 3,000, plug in 3,000 for your x value. And so you'll have P of 3,000 is negative 6,000 times natural log of 2, plus 6,000 times natural log of 3,000 after you replace the x, subtract 18,000, subtract 3,000. And so if you type this into a graphing calculator, you'll have this, negative 6,000 times natural log of 2, plus 6,000 times natural log of 3,000, subtract 18,000, and then subtract 3,000. So it's approximately equal to, rounded two decimal places, or the nearest cent, $22,879.32. That's the profit when 3,000 items are produced and sold. So then the second part says, find out the profit at 9,000 items. So P of 9,000 would be negative 6,000 times natural log of 2, plus 6,000 times natural log of 9,000, subtract 18,000, then subtract x, which was 9,000. So if you type this into a graphing calculator, the only thing that changed between the last problem that we typed in and this one is you want to take the 3,000 and change it to a 9,000 inside this logarithm, and the x was changed from 3,000 to 9,000. So second, enter to get what we last typed in. Scroll over to the natural log of the argument. That's now 9,000. Everything else stayed the same, except for the x is now 9,000. So you come up with approximately 23,470.996. And so notice that the 6 would round this 9 up to a 10, and then that would round up this 9 to a 10. And so if you round the two decimal places, you'll come up with $23,471.00. All right, a couple more parts for this problem. Part 4 says, find the rate of change of the total profit function when 3,000 items and 9,000 items are sold. Round your answers to the nearest cent. So this is talking about the rate of change of the total profit function, or marginal profit. So we found out the marginal profit function was p prime of x was 6,000 divided by x, and then subtract 1. That was what we came up with in part 2. We want to find out what's the rate of change at 3,000 items sold. So p prime of 3,000 would be 6,000 divided by 3,000, subtract 1. 6,000 divided by 3,000 is just 2, so 2 subtract 1 gives you 1. So that means that the profit function is changing at $1 per item sold when 3,000 items are produced and sold. And then the other part, what's the marginal profit function at 9,000? So P prime of 9,000 would be 6,000 divided by 9,000, subtract 1. 6,000 divided by 9,000 is 2/3 when you simplify. Then subtract 1 is negative 1/3. So negative 1/3, or if you round the two decimal places, is negative $0.33 per item sold when 9,000 items are produced and sold. And now the last part, how many items will be sold when the rate of change of the total profit is 0. So again, we're talking about rate of change of the total profit, so that's the derivative of profit. P p prime of x is 6,000 divided by x, subtract 1, when is this change in the profit function 0? So take the derivative and set it equal to 0. So you get this equation, 6,000 divided by x, subtract 1 is equal to 0. So add 1 to both sides of the equation first. So 6,000 divided by x is equal to 1. And now since x is in the denominator, multiply both sides of the equation by x. So 6,000 divided by x times x will cancel out the x from the denominator, and you'll have 6,000, and 1 times x is x. So x is equal to 6,000 items sold. So when 6,000 items are sold, the change in the profit is 0. The profit function is not changing. So this finishes our video on derivatives of logarithmic functions. If you have any questions about any of the examples in this video, please let me know. Or if you have any questions while you work on the homework for this section, please let me know that as well. And I'll see you at the next video when we talk about the product and quotient rules for derivatives.